I'm Caryl Matrisciana, author of the bestseller God's the New Age and producer of the documentary of the same title. Both trace the roots of the New Age movement and its basic practice of yoga consciousness to Hinduism, the religion of India, the land where I was born and raised for almost 20 years. Recently, I returned to India and had the opportunity to interview yogis who train their followers through various physical and mental exercises, and I questioned them about yoga's transformation. I also asked Indian experts if the practice of yoga consciousness could be separated from its Eastern spirituality and used as physical fitness only. By the 80s, the New Age consciousness movement, also known as the Human Potential movement, although knowingly rooted in Eastern philosophy, had successfully marketed yoga practice and Eastern meditation to the West as scientifically proven and beneficial for healthcare and mental well-being. Today, yoga practice is offered in up to 80% of health clubs, promoted on TV as a body toner and flexibility exercises, and offered to corporate employees as medical benefits to steady the mind, calm the emotions, and relax away stresses. Once essentially recognized by the church as part of the Hindu religion, today yoga is being practiced by Christians and promoted in many forms of exercise as Christian mind-body fitness and as a spiritual vehicle able to enhance a richer Christian walk. How did India's Eastern mysticism gain access into the West in so short a time and appear to totally change its very heart and message? For some answers, we need only go back to the 1960s, the birth of the hippie generation, the psychedelic drug culture of hallucinogenic drugs, and the heroes of an era.
The Beatles were instrumental trendsetters in music, fashion, style, language, and concepts that mirrored the spirit of their times. They were of the generation involved in drug experimentation and a search for mystical experience. As the Beatles' drug use increased, they tapped into a fresh, new musical dexterity reflecting their involvement in mind-altering chemicals. Millions of their fans mimicked their philosophical pursuit of peace and love, use of hallucinogenics, and followed them into their eventual embrace of Indian spirituality, Eastern mysticism, and yoga meditation. Because of George Harrison. Told the world press, "We're going to India to study transcendental meditation properly. We want to learn properly so we can propagate it and sell the whole idea to everyone. This is how we plan to use our power now. They've always called us leaders of youth, and we believe that this is a good way to give youth a lead. It needn't be religion if people don't want to connect it with religion. It's all in the mind, a way to calm down tensions, strengthen understanding, and make people more relaxed." Thus began the endorsement of yoga meditation as non-religious and its marketing to the West as mind science. Yoga meditation, acknowledged in the East as a mystical power able to alter consciousness, was launched on American campuses as a relaxation technique and stress management benefit separated from its Hindu roots. The lure of Eastern mysticism continued to grow as the hippie generation recognized similarities in yoga's altered states and those attained by drug use. Hinduism's leniency on drug use for religious trances was welcomed, as was its capability to shift states of consciousness without necessarily using drugs. George Harrison became a dedicated member of Hinduism's Hare Krishna consciousness movement, established by Swami Prabhupada. In his blockbuster hit song, My Sweet Lord, George effectively blended Eastern religion with traditional Western thought, becoming the first to successfully merge New Age mysticism into contemporary popular music. He created spiritual fusion by interchanging the names of Eastern deities like Krishna and Rama with the biblical worship themes of Alleluia and Lord God. The Beatles' syncretism began a cultural revolution. Indian mystics, gurus, swamis, yogis, and bhagwans invaded the West, becoming familiar household names, as did their various types of yoga contemplation and Eastern meditation. Even religious Hindu disciplines like vegetarianism for higher spiritual purity and the teaching of reincarnation, that after death a person can return in another body, became positive spiritual options to customary Western thinking. John Lennon had successfully achieved his spiritual goals to broadcast India's Eastern beliefs to everyone. But when he publicly announced that the Beatles were bigger than Jesus, not even his justification to the world press helped.
In reference to England, that we meant more to kids than Jesus did, or religion at that time. I wasn't knocking it or putting it down, I was just saying it as a fact.
Upheaval was already underway, with the Beatles playing an instrumental part in it. The Beatles' religious and political influence had far-reaching effects into the 70s and with generations to come. The religious-political syncretism they began with the amalgamation of Eastern spirituality combined with Western culture is still rapidly gaining global acceptance today.
Open for something like TM, and when it came to the Berkeley campus, well advertised with big posters and everywhere as a 5-year plan to bliss consciousness, I took the bait just like that.
Michael Graham, author of The Experience of Ultimate Truth, was an ardent practitioner of Eastern meditation and yoga for over 30 years, and explains why he pursued mind-expanding consciousness not through drugs, but Eastern philosophy.
I turned to Eastern mysticism beginning at about the age of 16. I'd read a couple of books that my father owned, and I was really excited by the promise of the Eastern spiritual tradition, a life free of suffering, personal transformation, and an experience of the highest truth. And that's what got me.
I had a sense of emptiness within. I didn't really know who I was. I was struggling with identity issues and a sense of not really knowing where I was going or what life was all about. And I thought perhaps TM would give me more meaning in life and that it would lift some of the anxiety or just the feeling of wondering what's going to happen. It promised us bliss.
I took up yoga in Melbourne, Australia, and meditation. I found meditation a very arduous practice, but 3 years later I found myself in India at the feet of Swami Muktananda Paramahansa, later to become a very well-renowned meditation master.
Dr. Jotiro is a college professor, author, and expert in Hinduism and yoga.
The first step in practicing yoga is always at the physical level. Only when you are able to control your thought process, you go on into the second level. The second level is the spiritual level.
First of all, I thought yoga was a process of physical exercise that led to greater health, buoyancy, vitality. And also I knew it was coupled with meditation, but when I first began, I wasn't quite clear about the connection.
Dr. George Alexander, associate professor, author of Yoga, The Truth Behind the Posture.
Today in the West, about 35 million Americans are into yoga, just seeing yoga as a physical fitness. Yoga is a Hindu word, yoga is a Hindu discipline to become one with the universal consciousness, which means become one with God. Which God? Brahma, the Hindu God. There are many various paths to yoga. In the sacred text of Hinduism called Bhagavad Gita indicates three different paths. First of all, Bhaktiveda is a focus on a deity. Then Jnana Yoga is a focus on wisdom. Then the Karma Yoga is based on your good deeds and actions.
You have a number of yogas. Yoga is not one entity, but it has a wide variety of yogas. Each yoga has the physical aspect and the spiritual aspect. The physical aspect is controlling the physical body. They control the breathing, they control the mind, thinking activity, they control the physical movements, and the timely behavior to discipline the body in the morning, night, how to control the bowel movement. These are all the forms of the physical part of the yoga.
If you're practicing Jnana Yoga, or should I say a Raja Yoga, the primary focus of that technique is to bring the mind into perfect stillness and to focus the mind in a very deliberate way on a particular sound or vibration or image, as it may be in the Tibetan Mahayana tradition of Buddhism, that brings the mind into a state of quiescence, peace, such that revelation can occur, experiential penetration of a higher truth or another truth. So it's a way of manipulating the mind to generate different experiences or insights or cognitions that are supposed to be connected to the apprehension, experiential apprehension of higher realities.
According to Hinduism, the highest reality is to become aware of one's own divinity. Hinduism respects everything as deity: the cows on the street, the monkeys in the city, the idols which are half men, half animal-like creatures. But the highest goal is realization of one's personal divinity or God consciousness. This realization can be experienced through direct perception deep within one's own mind, a place known as the seat of concentrated wisdom, an area between the eyebrows, which is known as the third eye. It is also called the sixth chakra, meaning wheel, and recognized as psychic energy. The other chakras are said to run along the spine, starting at the bottom, blossoming at the top, meeting at the Agna, meaning command. Here, at the Agna, the third eye is the central point where all experience is gathered in total concentration and is also believed to be the base of all creation itself. In this hotel where I was staying, each morning the local priest would come to offer the morning puja or prayer rituals to the gods. He'd prepare arati, the celebration of light through fire, and mix the vermilion red mixture for bindi or kumkum, the dot seen between the eyebrows. This bindi or kumkum is believed to retain psychic energy in the human body and control the various levels of concentration. Here, the hotel manager explains that the bindi or kumkum and arati fire are being prepared not only for the gods, but also the hotel guests who are esteemed as gods.
For our gods, we place this kumkum as a tradition. Okay? The guests are our god. The guests who's coming in here are our gods. Okay? So we keep the bindi, we do the arati and the bindi for the guest. They are like our gods.
In Hinduism, they have more than 330 million gods. That means everything is God. Whatever you see, whatever you touch is God. And the sun god, the moon god, and all everything is God. So man and nature, man and animal are one.
The idea of meditation is that you contact experientially the inner self when recognized as it is one with God, or identical with God, the God within, the self within, both identical. And the idea of the meditator is to have an experiential appreciation of the God within.
Classical Hinduism and yoga, which are synonymous, assert this universe we live in and are part of is the manifestation of Brahma, the infinite, all-embracing, ever-blissful supreme being that is a consciousness. Shiva is both an impersonal force and a god, and eternal consciousness. His consort, the goddess Shakti, is his creative power. Both these principles cannot be distinct entities. They are two poles of the one being experiencing itself. According to Shiva's wish and under the influence of Shakti, we living beings identify with material and mental objects created by Shakti and feel incomplete because we're not connected with Shiva, the eternal consciousness.
Dr. Victor Chowdhury, a leading cancer surgeon in India, is also a well-known lecturer and author of many books.
The word yoga in Hindi language means union, as simple as that. And the purpose of this union is, they think there is a power called kundalini in their spine, at the back, at the base of their spine, which is a kind of coiled serpent. And the idea is when this union takes place, this serpent is uncoiled and then it travels into their minds and releases the third eye. The third eye is means the Shiva, the god Shiva.
In Hinduism, the serpent is a very prominent deity, or many people worship serpents. I have seen many snake temples or serpent temples in India. If you look at the picture of Lord Shiva in Hinduism, you see a snake wrapped around his neck. They believe that the serpent power is in every person, and the serpent power is sleeping in you. By practicing yoga, they awake that kundalini power in you. Actually, kundalini is a name for a cobra. So when the kundalini power is awakened, that goes up to the brain and awaken the psychic power.
In most cultures, the serpent is seen as a positive creature and worshipped for its wisdom. Only in the Bible is the serpent described as the creator God's enemy, a usurper who wishes to take God's rightful place in the mind of mankind. In Hinduism, he is called the Kundalini and believed to be able to be awakened through yoga meditation and grant the practitioner an awareness of God, a stillness, a God consciousness.
The awakening that I received from Muktananda was called and regarded as the awakening of the Kundalini Shakti. The Kundalini, the serpent power rising, if you like. It was given a very positive spin. It was the intelligence of the life force itself. It was divine in origin. And the experience I had of that was an ascending force from time to time. And I experienced the flowering of the stomach chakra on a particular day when it was pierced. But by and large, the form of the experience that Muktananda precipitated in other people seemed to have a much wider context, to be far more broad band than merely the idea of the ascending current going through the different chakras leading up to the crown chakra. So I had glimpses and moments of Kundalini experience, but the spiritual charismatic experience I had were much broader than that.
Author Jean Lim, lecturer and authority on the supernatural, lives in Malaysia.
Yoga is actually a form of spiritual exercise, and those who practice yoga, they will be filled, you know, with the spirit of yoga, that is the spirit of the serpent.
When the spirit of Kundalini is uncoiled, there is a movement of body, serpent-like movement. So a lot of original yoga has serpent-like movement, you can see that. So that's very much part and parcel of or certain other weird movements which come in are very much part of the Python spirit.
I don't think we can separate yoga, the practice of yoga, from the spiritual into just a form of exercise, because every form of the yoga movement derives from the serpent. And there's a root behind it. So when a person practices yoga, he's actually indirectly bowing down to the god of the serpent.
The Kundalini experience is classically described by Sir John Woodroffe. It's spoken about in the Western tradition and in the Eastern tradition, and it's associated with the rising energy coming up through the plexuses of energy between the Muladhara, the chakra, at the bottom of the spine, and the Sahasrara, at the top of the spine. As the plexuses are pierced through time, so all the 72,000 channels of nerves throughout the body-mind and subtle body are purified. And the idea is that through this purification, you're able to access an experiential appreciation of the highest truth, or God.
You go on into the second level. The second level is the spiritual level, trying to develop the thought that you are not a human being altogether, but you are beyond your human body. You have identity with the deity, you have the divine qualities, and slowly as you go on meditating, you attain that status equal with God.
The idea of the meditator is to have an experiential appreciation of the God within. In fact, the great statement that comes out of the Eastern tradition is Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahman, or Soham, He I am. So the idea is to have, as an experience, your identity with God, all it is.
In the Bible, the serpent beguiled Eve by his cunning and seduced her mind, corrupting her from sincere, wholehearted, and pure devotion to God. He deceived her into believing a lie, that she, through her reason, could be God. And ironically, yoga arousal of snake power, the mind-altering experience of Kundalini spirit in the body, continues to deceive all its practitioners of the same lie.
The Bible says that that same old serpent, the dragon, has gone to deceive the whole world. And the spirit of the serpent tries to deceive the whole world, not to possess their body.
I immediately felt a change come over me. I immediately felt tension go off of me.
What probably drew me on more than anything was the extraordinary, vibrant, charismatic awakening that I received from Muktananda, that manifested me in me as a continuous and continual movement of energy within me.
I started having spiritual experiences. I started having visions at night, and I started having psychic experiences.
It would form itself as a classical dancing postures, or speaking in tongues, or spontaneous breathing rhythms, or periods of complete peace, or the seeing of lights, the movement of the body into all sorts of extraordinary shapes and forms, not resembling hatha yoga as a matter of fact, but all spontaneously executed.
I just had more, like they would say, increased awareness of, on a spiritual plane of things happening.
It was dynamic, it was palpable. It wasn't as though I had to sort of cooperate with something and get into a drift. that might suggest the connection of hysteria or suggestion or hypnosis, nothing like that. It just sort of took me over and worked me.
One of the promises of being a teacher of transcendental meditation is that it would develop your awareness much more quickly. And every time that we would do an initiation ceremony, it would speed us ahead, light years, in our evolution.
Can there be a physical yoga without spiritual yoga? The answer is no, because they are all part and parcel of the same thing. The python is not a poisonous snake. Python kills by strangulating. It just winds itself around its victim and stifles it or strangulates it, and then it kills its victim and then swallows it.
The Bhagavad Gita, a sacred Hindu text, teaches joy supreme comes to the yoga practitioner who becomes one with Brahman, the Hindu God consciousness. Time magazine recently exposed a controversy on yoga, reporting that yoga purists claim Hinduism is not like a recipe ingredient that can be extracted from yoga. At the Hindu University of America in Orlando, Florida, a professor of yoga philosophy and meditation states, yoga is Hinduism. Yet many espousing to be Christians say they can adapt the Hindu religion with Christian terms and concepts. Hinduism Today, a leading Indian publication, admits that Hinduism is the soul of yoga, based as it is on Hindu scripture and developed by Hindu sages. Yoga opens up new and more refined states of mind, and to understand them, one needs to believe in and understand the Hindu way of looking at God. A Christian trying to adapt these practices will likely disrupt their own Christian beliefs.
There are two distinct worldviews, quite in opposition to each other, and contrasting in their views on creation, God's person, and man's eternal future. The biblical worldview teaches God is the creator and outside of creation. He's a personal God, manifest in three persons, the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit, also known as the Comforter. The biblical worldview says man is a sinner, fallen from his original state of perfection due to his choice to disobey God. But God, in his love, has provided complete forgiveness of sin through his plan of redemption, the atoning work of Jesus Christ at the crucifixion. If man does not choose God's way of salvation, he will have chosen the consequence of eternal separation from God, an eternity in hell. The Bible's message of hope in Jesus is both for the present and the future. It promises Jesus will return to earth and reign for 1,000 years, after which there will be the white throne judgment and the rolling up of this old earth and the establishment of a new heaven, which Jesus assured his disciples he was going back to prepare in his Father's house for those who faithfully love and obey him. The Eastern mystical New Age worldview teaches within man are the answers for salvation through mind-altering techniques like Hindu yoga concentration, Eastern meditation, and spiritual contemplative prayer, to name a few. Its main tenets are pantheism, that God, an impersonal force, is all, and panentheism, that God's presence is in all. That humanity is also divinity, a change in consciousness is necessary, and some type of consciousness evolution, global paradigm shift, will ultimately save mankind and take it to the next level. New Agers believe a type of human savior will bring world peace and safety and be admired as a global political religious leader. Interestingly, the Bible tells of such a person and says he's the Antichrist, an impersonator who seems to be Christ, who'll set himself up for world adulation prior to Christ's 1,000-year reign. For the success of such a global deception, there must already be in place a massive spiritual conditioning process. Many consider today's New Age spiritual consciousness movement as the setup. Since the 1960s, the New Age movement has been attempting to mix the two opposing worldviews and separate them from their Hindu root and biblical tradition. But more recently, the East and Western spiritual blend has swelled within the Christian church, practiced by growing millions in their ranks and calling itself Christian.
Time magazine reports Christian yoga is gaining a devout following but upsetting purists, Hindus, and some Christians. In its article, Stretching for Jesus, Cindy Senarigi, founder of Yoga Devotion, gives support to a whole new movement of spiritual thinkers who don't adhere to Hinduism's beliefs or the Bible's.
The one or two comments that I've gotten from both ends of the spectrum, whether it's fundamental Hindus or fundamental Christians, there's a huge, wide group of people right down the middle that understand yoga in a different way than either of those groups do. They understand the Western practice of yoga, of the physical use, the physical practice of yoga being not only good for them physically, but emotionally, and as they said, spiritually, being able to be in prayer and meditation.
We have a huge group of people call themselves Christians, but their teachings are not based on the Word of God. So as a result, they believe that they can blend Christian teaching along with the Eastern meditation.
When I took the first class at the fitness center that I was training at, I walked in and I said to the woman that was teaching the class, I just want to let you know that I'm a Christian and you are not going to mess with my mind. The church that I had come from had been telling us that yoga was not good for us because it opened our minds, and in that open space there was a potential for evil. The woman looked at me and she said, I'm a Christian too, and I'm not planning to mess with your mind.
The Christian who partakes in Hindu yoga meditation is perhaps not knowingly surrendering their mind in the classical Hindu understanding of submission, but the Christian is having their worldview changed and compromising the teachings of the Word of God.
In transcendental meditation, we were taught that the technique would cause us to come to a place of no thought, where our mind would be totally emptied. He talked about it as like going down into the ocean and experiencing the bottom of the ocean. It's a place of no thought, and he calls it a place of transcendence, where you would transcend thinking. And the more you would go to that place and touch on that and enter into that transcending place, the more evolved or closer to cosmic consciousness you would get.
Meditation has become such a popular word in our society today. In the Eastern meditation, the main purpose of meditation is to detach, because Eastern meditation teaches us that a rational mind cannot find or cannot reach the absolute truth. So you have to cut off all your rational thinking and emotions so that your mind will be emptied, so that you can reach the realization one with the universe.
Yoga practitioners must first master the physical postures and movements of yoga meditation to experience the stilling of the mind. The physical technique, itself a Hindu ritual, triggers the supernatural entrance of so-called God presence.
After the physical practice of yoga, when I did sit quiet and still, I noticed that I was in the presence of God in a way that I had never been before. The more I practiced, the more I experienced God's presence.
The presence of God within a biblical context can't be manipulated by man's desire for such a presence. Yoga positions facilitate altered states for the mind to experience a mystical presence. The biblical God can only be accessed through Jesus Christ, his Son, who claimed, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. The Christian can maintain a personal connection with God by continually abiding in Jesus and staying obedient to his commandments through the power of his Spirit. There are no body movements or special positions necessary to bring one into communion with God's Spirit. The connection has been remedied by Jesus Christ himself.
We have this basic belief that the physical poses, the hatha poses, which is the basis of almost all yoga, is hatha poses, the asanas, and we use it in a flow. It's called a vinyasa. In other words, we don't just stay in one pose and go to the next pose. We connect the flow.
The hatha yoga, I always regarded it as simply a physical exercise. I never saw it as a spiritual exercise. But Maharishi used to tell us that if all we did was the yoga, that we would eventually get to cosmic consciousness because of the kundalini.
A mystical presence is stimulated by the mind through the movements themselves. The exercise can't be neutral or separated from the philosophy, which accepts that a consciousness change will take place. Hatha, or physical poses, asana movements, whatever they be named, are deliberately positioned to oppress or force the flow of kundalini spirit, a spiritual message, to move into the body.
Yoga again has the outward form and the inward form, the physical one and the spiritual one. And none of these pastors are able to distinguish between the physical aspect and the spiritual aspect. They think it's only physical exercise. And they try to introduce this to the common man. Common man always blunders because he can't differentiate.
Many of the Hindu yoga postures are derived after animals and nature. The sun is the original teacher of yoga, and today, as a result, most of the Hindus worship the sun god.
The Hindu sun worship is based on its importance in agriculture. But offering appeasement or worship to the sun, or indeed any created thing, is not a biblical teaching. Scriptures say the Creator God alone, as the giver of life, is deserving of man's gratitude. Christians involved in any form of aerobics, combining spiritual supplications, worship, or the receiving of subliminal messaging through any means, are involved in pagan ritual worship. Exercises for a healthy body need only focus on making the body healthy. But physical workouts that combine body maintenance with seeking supernatural presence are treading on dangerous spiritual arenas. Yoga postures are designed to unite the practitioner with the powerful deity the position represents. Merely changing the name to a biblical concept doesn't negate the source of the power within the technique. It's rooted in cobra arousal, and the serpent is Creator God's archenemy.
We have one flow that we like to call the creation flow. Where we lift our hands in praise and thanksgiving, and we bow down to the Lord our God. Lifting our hands in praise and thanksgiving, and exhale, bowing down to the Lord our God.
Kundalini, by volitionally practicing pranayama, which is control of the breath, controlling the breath in certain rhythms and holding patterns, that can awaken it. On the other hand, when it's awakened, through a guru or in precipitated in some spontaneous way, the breathing follows the awakening spontaneously.
The pranayama, the breath that they use to connect in their practice, as I understand it, is what we call breath prayer in our practice. We use the ujjayi breathing. It's a great breath technique physically, and we use it throughout our practice in our standing poses and our floor poses.
The use of breath techniques awakens snake power to bring a change in consciousness. Its use by Christians doesn't change its spiritual power or intention. For the Christian to call the spirits by other names is to their advantage. They don't mind being renamed from Hindu deities to biblical names, Holy Spirit, Jesus, Amen, or a scripture verse. All they want is entrance into the practitioner's mind to stop God's blessings and corrupt God's scriptures and plans of freedom in Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit, peace be with you.
Breathing is a very important part of all yoga postures. So that has been taken from the biblical teaching. For example, when God created Adam, he gave life to Adam by breathing into Adam. So that has been taken in Hinduism yoga to breathe. But the more you breathe, the more you breathe, that doesn't make any change for you to become like God.
Let's just hold for one breath prayer, again using your favorite scripture or even the word Amen or the name Jesus.
The Bible clearly teaches that there is power in our words. So when you repeat a name of a deity, there is so much of power, and the power comes into you.
In some yogas or some Eastern techniques, you actually make verbal affirmations or call on names of gods, but like the Om, for instance, you intone it. Well, with TM, of course, it's silent.
Om is perfectly Hindu concept of the deity who is impersonal, who is beyond creation, who is not having any attributes, neither good nor bad. There is no distinction between good and evil. So this concept of the impersonal force as Om, that is being misused to bring in Christ as the Om. So Christ, they try to interpret as an impersonal being, a force, who neither has good nor evil.
A mantra is a repeated word, but they focus on a deity. So when you call upon that name by repeating, by chanting, you invite that spirit to come into you.
If you're calling on a name of an entity, they most likely will perk up their ears and come to you and become your spirit guide.
You cannot force Jesus to come into your life, but mantra is something that you are forcing a spirit to come into your life. But Bible very clearly teaches you cannot force the Spirit of God to come into your life by repeating His name.
One of the ways that I encourage my students to bring their yoga practice and their Christian spiritual practice together is to think about a favorite Bible verse or scripture or maybe a Christian mantra such as the word Jesus or Amen, and connect that with their body and their mind and their spirit in practice.
You can use any word, and by repeating it over and over again, you can expand your awareness and become more relaxed and get rid of stress in your nervous system. But I really sincerely believe that it shuts down or represses the nervous system. It's not something good.
Shutting down from life's reality is the goal of yoga. Its end result has similar effects to drug-induced states, with psychological changes in the body and brain, with euphoric experiences, some of which are actually very dangerous. Mysticism and substance abuse have remarkable similarities, yet, despite the dangers, yoga devotion is promoted as a beneficial body-mind exercise.
And don't think for a moment that it's not having an effect on you. It will influence your worldview, the way you see reality, and they are powerful beings not to be underestimated.
God created all the angels, but there were a group of angels who do not want to obey God, so as a result they rebelled, and they became the fallen angels. The duty of the fallen angels today is to manipulate and to detach us from God.
Fallen angels who rebelled against God are quick to enter their victim and manifest in whatever form they're called upon. They enter through visualization or imaging techniques, and because they're liars, are able to manipulate the Christian's mind to see them as Jesus or whoever. But the technique of conjuring up is no less offensive to God, no matter what the image. So making an idol out of one's spiritual imagination or one's mind is tantamount to carving an idol with hands. Connecting with spirit guides is idolatry. The Our Father prayer Jesus taught says, "Thy will be done." We are under submission to God's will in our lives, His timing and His plans. We can't will the Creator God to appear at our bidding. Christians fall prey to seducing spirits and doctrines of demons when they invite imaginations embodied in serpent power to enter their rituals, even if the names are changed to names like spinal integrity or cobra.
We move into what we call spinal integrity, which is another part of our practice that we actually learned from our yogi here in Minnesota.
And we turn to neutral spine and rest on your belly. Lengthen your toes and press the tops of your feet into the floor. Using your back muscles, inhale, cobra. And exhale, come down, turn your head to the right and rest for one breath prayer.
Inhale up one vertebrae at a time. And as the breath travels up the spine, imagine that it travels out from the spine, along the nerves, into the muscles, bringing the very breath of God into every cell of your body.
The danger of mystical visualization techniques, imagining your breath traveling or picturing a so-called energy moving, all these techniques are self-induced mind changes. It's the work of the same old snake with the same old lie wrapped in psychological terminology and more inappropriately in Christian vocabulary.
Some Christians believe that you can Christianize anything, including yoga. All you do is cut off the Hindu part of it.
The Bible is the Creator's manual. He made His word flesh in the appearing of Jesus, and we can learn all about our personal God through Holy Scripture. It's living because Jesus is resurrected and living. It's active and sharper than any two-edged sword and available for our use in spiritual warfare to overcome the fallen spirit world because Jesus overcame the fallen spirit world and death. The spirit of the Bible is truth and fully able to equip us with truth to combat spiritual error and deception. When the church fails to provide the members with the knowledge of the power of the word and the tools in it, then liberal theology abounds and a watered-down gospel permeates the world. Eastern mysticism teaches there's no absolute truth. All is based on subjectivity and relativity. Established on its foundation of evolution, it claims all is ever-changing, developing into other forms. God claims truth is absolute. He is truth. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He gives principles for right living and doing and sets moral boundaries for our own well-being and protection based on His character and authority. Today's politically correct multicultural society, in the name of freedom, has prejudiced the truth of God. But the Bible warns, there's a way which seems right to a man and appears straight before him, but at the end of it is the way of death. Today's spiritual choices appear to give freedom, but ultimately they bring spiritual bondage.
In postmodern thinking today, there are no absolutes. People just throw away the absolutes and they just take what they want. As a result, people have no concept of boundaries. They can do whatever they want. Because people have not taken the Bible seriously, today we have seen so many so-called Christians getting into Christian mysticism. But Bible has given the clear directions, and Bible has everything that you need today for a good life. So the Bible must be the theme and the foundation for your meditation and for your life.
The classical Eastern position came over on the waves of the Swami's invasions in the 50s and the 60s, but that was taken over in the 80s by the Tibetan Buddhism with the Dalai Lama at the head. You've got the Eastern spirituality that's been redressed for the American consumer under Swamis and yoga teachers, teachers of meditation. You have the world of mind dynamics, psychic development, Reiki healing, native earth religions, astrology, psychologism, yoga, meditation.
We are using a Western style of yoga and combining it with our Christian spiritual practices to nurture the light of Christ that burns within each of us and to feel the unconditional love of God.
All these things are sort of a heady cocktail of possibilities that have come out, emerged in the West, come from the East, and are now suffused through all the women's magazines, television, movies you see. It's on every corner, in every head, and on every tongue. And it's all happened by stealth.
Jesus cautioned there'd be false spiritual teachers before he returned. And the Bible says in the last days there'll be a falling away of Christians from the Bible. It says there'll be an apostasy when spirits of seduction will beguile and deceive with counterfeit doctrines and lying corruption. Yoga meditation is just one of thousands of erroneous wisdoms present today. But the most insidious heartbreak is the deception within the church, with its own members manipulating and twisting God's word, Christian traditions, biblical prayer, and the work of Jesus, claiming yoga positions are the same as Jesus giving his body for the sins of the world.
India's Vishva Hindu Parishad, the world's largest missionary organization, launched an ambitious missionary effort in 1979 in Allahabad, India. At the Second World Congress on Hinduism, attended by about 60,000 delegates from around the world, one of the speakers announced, "Our mission in the West has been crowned with fantastic success. Hinduism is becoming the dominant world religion, and the end of Christianity has come near." Yoga teachers in the West have become the leading missionaries of Hinduism and number anywhere up to 70,000 in more than 20,000 locations across America, teaching an estimated 35 to 40 million fitness fanatics, aging baby boomers, and other unlikely enthusiasts who claim the mind, body, spiritual workouts, physical stretching, and breathing exercises are wholesome for one's health and mind, achieving everything from healing to tightening abs. Yoga is experiencing a renaissance worldwide and is nationally a $27 billion industry offering stress and burnout reduction, concentration benefits, and self-confidence to pregnant women, business people, and senior citizens. It is promoted in hospital programs as alternative medical therapy and claims to reduce blood pressure and benefit the heart. The Target Store's website offers 4,235 yoga products, and Walmart's website offers 990 yoga products. A simple search on Amazon.com of yoga books brings up 18,700 results, and Google.com displays almost 32 million, making the ancient philosophy of Hindu yoga part of mainstream Western culture. Hatha yoga is taught in YMCAs and YWCAs as physical education, adapted in health spas as wellness programs and relaxation techniques, and presented on TV as physical fitness exercises. Nike, HBO, Forbes, Apple, and scores more Fortune 500 companies consider yoga meditation important enough to offer in classes as a regular employee benefit. Newsweek reported that yoga classes are in demand at urban health clubs across the country. As the practice of yoga has been secularized, a new wave of Christian yoga and spiritual-based aerobic and workout alternatives packaged in Christian terminology have mushroomed across the nation. Once viewed by Christianity as a heathen import from the East and taboo for the church, today yoga practice is accepted as benign and offered as outstretched in worship classes or Christ-centered yoga classes. An aspiring Christian consciousness has entwined with basic Hindu yoga consciousness using yoga movements, postures, breathing concentration, and repetitive prayer and being accompanied with Christian themes, music, prayers and worship, or biblical verses and Bible names. Thomas Keating, in his book Open Mind, Open Heart, renames Eastern meditation techniques as centering, contemplative prayer, or transformation into Christ. He writes, "This basic core of goodness is capable of unlimited development, indeed, of becoming transformed into Christ and deified." Leading Christian publishers promote numerous books and videos on yoga for Christians, blending breath methods and meditative techniques, claiming improvement for a concentrated prayer life and empowered Christian living. Ignoring the emotional dangers of occult dabbling, parapsychological harms associated with serpent arousal, and disregarding biblical warnings to stay apart from paganism, growing numbers of churches and church leaders are offering blended mystical and New Age programs and yoga outreaches to their community.
We have a Saturday morning yoga on the beach class that we do to sponsor and provide funds for cancer research. From the two churches that we began in, we've expanded into 14 other churches and growing. We have 14 instructors that go into these churches bringing the Christian practices of prayer and meditation into the settings that the people come to for worship.
Classical Hinduism was not missionary-minded in the sense that yoga spirituality is part of acquiring one's own salvation through recognizing that the individual is God. Within that self-realization, the practitioner can shorten his reincarnation cycles, but he doesn't go out proselytizing. When the British ruled India, they introduced the idea of serving the community with the supply of hospitals and schools, an idea that conflicts with Hinduism's teaching on karma. Karma says the shortcomings or sufferings one is undergoing in this life is due to what has been done in previous lives, therefore helping through medicine, healing, or education is in essence to tinker with one's karma. In India today, there are many community-based programs borrowed from the biblical model of reaching out to widows, orphans, the sick and needy. Part of the new strategy of Hinduism is to market yoga as a self-realization program that can solve all life's problems. Yoga teachers in the West are not the only missionaries for Hinduism. Business corporations, hospitals, and educational facilities that would not think of promoting Bible studies or Christian values as a positive alternative in the workplace are the aggressive missionaries for Eastern mysticism today.
Non-dualism means there is no concept of absolute truth, which means there is no concept of good and evil. A lot of people don't believe in sin concept today. Even in the West today, not many people believe that Satan is a person, is a person, but a lot of people believe Satan is a force, just a force. So in the non-dualism concept today, especially younger generation, they have no idea of right and wrong. So they follow whatever their instincts inspires them to do.
When I was practicing Eastern mysticism, sin was never taken very seriously. I noticed that once Hinduism and Buddhism became redressed for the American or first world consumer, they left all the teeth of the idea of sin and how that rocks your spiritual life at home in India. But by the time it got to the West, sin was downplayed.
I think if we were brutally honest, we would all admit that we have shortcomings. and recognize that we are somehow separated from God. But rather than rely on God's direction to fix the maladjustment, we tend to want to fix it ourselves through our own self-helps, whatever they be, based on psychology, rationalization, or any spiritual technique. The Bible says the wages of sin brings death. The Hindu says ignorance brings separation. The Christian says it's personal sin, and God offered his Son as the bridge to God and eternity. Yoga says it's ignorance of divine self and offers mind-altering techniques of enlightenment to bring release for this life and postponement of death through reincarnation.
Pandit Motilal Nehru, one of the great Indian philosophers and authority on yoga, says, "The aim of yoga is to realize liberation from the human condition. To achieve this liberation, various psychological, physical, mental, and mystical methods have been devised. All those methods are antisocial in that yoga prescribes a way of life which says, this mortal life is not worth living."
Yoga is meant to liberate your soul from your body, because in Hinduism, your body is Maya, an illusion, and the soul is trapped in your body. So yoga is meant to separate your soul from the body. So who practices yoga? People who are in the Hindu philosophy, they believe in that, and the last stage of life, to build a good karma, they practice yoga so their soul can be liberated. So they want to see the end of this life in preparation for the next life, for a better reincarnation.
No matter how yoga is packaged as a program for better life, its basic philosophical foundation is to prepare one for death, which Hindus don't see as the final stage, but a temporary delay while on life's continual journeys. Gandhi called reincarnation a hopeless cycle of imprisonment.
Salvation, biblical concept, is the forgiveness of sin. Whereas the Hindutva teaches the same word, they attribute, but give a different meaning. This is the release from the Punarjanma. The Punarjanma is the theology of Hindutva, where the soul is eternal and takes bodies over one after the other. They are born, they go through the lifespan, they die. They are reborn with a different body, not necessarily human, not necessarily living being. This is how they interpret the theology of the Hindutva, that creator is the creation and creation is the creator. There is no distinction between creator and creation. So every creature is a deity for the Hindu.
I believed in reincarnation, but some people really got into going into their past lives and all that. I really wasn't that interested in it, but part of the wonder of being a Christian was discovering that we just have one life to live, and it's for Christ.
The Eastern view is self-centric, it deifies the self. The New Age movement is focused on the self, it's self-centric. Whereas in contrast, the biblical view, the classical biblical view that originated with Jesus Christ, was God-centric, which is a huge difference. In other words, we look to God. We look to the loss of self rather than the gaining and deification of self. We look at the gracious loss of self that we may apprehend and the great truth of God become ours in experience.
As a transcendental meditation teacher, I still felt an emptiness inside. In fact, the more I meditated, the more empty I felt. Going deep within and experiencing the ground of my own being can be a pretty lonely place. You're very isolated. You go down and touch this level in yourself that is just you, yourself, and yourself. And there's really nothing else, and it's empty.
The Bible clearly says there is no good thing in our heart. Our heart even can be deceived. So how can you depend on your own experiences? and for peace and fulfillment.
The uniqueness of Christianity, the uniqueness of Christ, is that salvation is offered by fiat, not by process. We are saved by the declaration and the power of God.